Magnus Maria Hell from Infineon. He is presenting the physical layer in the KinXL world. He is working with Infineon, and he got his got a he was a degree of engineering from the University of Applied Science in Kaiserslautern in Germany. And he started with in Siemens Halbleiter, which is now Siemens Semiconductor, which is now since 1999 Infineon, well known for smart power devices. Later on in 1997, 10 years later, so he was a design engineer for CAN and LIN transceivers. And 3 years later, he was member of several standardization bodies, including GIFT, ISO, SAE, and last not least, CIA. And in CIA, he is the chairman of the Task Force for KinXL Physical Layer, as well as chairman for the Special Interest Group Electromagnetic Compatibility. Magnus, I know him since several years, and I appreciate that he will give the presentation, because I learned personally a lot from him about a physical layer. So my expertise is more in the higher layer protocols, but I'm also dealing with physical layers. And I got a lot of advice from him, to learn from him. I hope he will provide us sufficient information today to get a better understanding on the KinXL world. So Magnus, I can't say please take the floor. I can't say please take the stairs. Today I have to say please take the window, or please take the screen.
Thank you very much, Holger. Yeah, a warm welcome from my side also to you, and I'm happy that you are joining my presentation. And yeah, I was a little bit surprised that I have seen on the agenda there's a physical layer presentation as the first one on the International CAN conference. That means the physical layer becomes more and more important, and this is really what I also like to say to you: have a more detailed look into the physical layer, because the higher bit rates needs much more investigation in the physical layer itself and much more understanding than in the past. But at first, I will start, as Holger has done, a little bit with the history after a look on the agenda, where we'll at first start with a overview of transceiver versus protocol. Then I will a little bit present you some physical layer basics, and I will give you an introduction into the so-called SIC concept, the signal improvement capability concept, this new kind of transceiver, which is meanwhile on the market. And then I will also have a look on the new CAN-SIC XL transceiver, and my talk will end with a conclusion. And also a hint on the webinar about physical layer on Thursday morning, 9 o'clock Central European summertime. But now a little bit a look into the history. And it's a little bit curious, I would say, at the beginning, as CAN was introduced in cars, the physical layer was able to support up to 500 kilobit. But after that, some people are feeling not really well with 500 kilobit and untreated twisted pairs. They said, okay, if there are some failures on the bus, like shorts or open wires, then we have to look for a solution that, although under the circumstances, the physical layer can work in a reliable manner, and though the fault-tolerant low-speed CAN transceiver was born in 1996. But this concept was not so proven, though the meanwhile, nobody will follow this concept, but at the time, it was really a next step of improvement. But some OEMs said, okay, CAN is nice, I will use it, but two wires, it's too expensive. We have to find a solution for a single wire. And so also the investigation and development of a single wire CAN transceiver was started. So the bit rate was decreasing over time. And this was, from my point of view, a little bit of a curious situation if you compare it with the today movement on bit rates. But in parallel, also OEM said, we have to improve the existing 500 kilobit CAN transceiver. And we have to add a feature which is called remote bus wake up. And this Here, the first samples were available in 2003, so more or less 10 years later. And also 10 years later, the next energy efficient transceiver called partial network transceiver or selective fake transceiver was also born. And you see, bit rate was over 20 years, more than 20 years, always 500 kilobit. And 2012, that was the point where also the feedback was coming, 500 kilobit is not enough anymore. We need higher bit rates. And together with the CANFD protocol, which allows higher bit rates, also the bit rate in the physical layer increases with CANFD transceiver, which were available around about in 2016. But although here the information was, it's not enough. We have to improve it. We have to find new concept. And in 2019 now, the signal improvement capable transceiver was born. That was a step from 500 kilobit to 5 megabit by factor 10. And now a new star is born called CANSIG XL transceiver. And here the target is to achieve up to 20 megabit in CAN networks. So it means from 500 kilobit to 20 megabits in less than 10 years. And this is a great achievement, I would say. Okay, transceiver versus protocol. And here I have an important message to you. A lot of times I heard, okay, I'm using CANFD protocol. I must use a CANFD transceiver for CANFD protocol. This is not correct. You don't need, it's not a must to use a CANFD transceiver if you use CANFD protocol. Here are the combinations which are possible for CANFD protocol. So you can use all kind of physical layer concepts like single wire CAN, fault tolerant, and so on, up to the new CANSIG XL transceiver. The only limitation you have is the maximum possible bit rate in the network. So the transceiver limits your maximum possible bit rate, but it's not a must that you have to use CANFD transceiver in combination with the CANFD protocol. You can also use CANSIG, CANSIG XL, or all other kind of transceiver. And it's the same with our new CANXL protocol. If this makes sense to use CANXL protocol with single wire CAN transceiver, this is another story, but in general, you can use all kind of this CAN transceiver with the new CANXL protocol too. The only exception is if you like to use bit rates above 8 megabit, then you need the new mode in the CANSIG XL transceiver, which allows higher bit rate. And this is only possible with CANXL protocol because this mode change is only implemented in this CANXL protocol. So CANXL protocol with all other kind of transceivers can use up to the maximum possible bit rate, which this kind of transceiver supports, but the 20 megabits are only possible with the CANXL and the CANSIG XL transceiver. This is really a main message that you see that CANXL is very flexible and it's not a must to use the CANSIG XL transceiver. Now we are coming to physical layer basics and a little bit also to the requirements on a CAN physical layer. So in CAN physical layer, you have to support more than two nodes, minimum two, but more. This is the main requirement in one network without any switches and so on. And also a main requirement is that this kind of physical layer has to support a star topology, not only a linear topology or a daisy chain topology and a point-to-point topology, also the much more critical star topology has to be supported. And from the protocol, there's a requirement also CSMA for arbitration and error frames has to be supported with this physical layer concept. And so the outcome was that the transceiver cannot control both levels, one and zero, or dominant and recessive. So with the existing CAN transceiver, only the dominant level on the bus can be controlled by the transmitter. The recessive level is controlled by the network itself. And so it is possible that two or more nodes can transmit a dominant signal at the same time without a disturbance and without damage of the buses. And this means with this physical layer concept can, in general, can be supported only. How looks this transmitter concept, for example, of a CAN FD transceiver? It's the same also with the other kind of transceiver. So we have here at the beginning a phase called recessive. And in this phase, the transmitter of a transmitting node or of all nodes is really high impedant. Minimum 12 kilo ohm, this is defined in the ISO, but normally this impedance is much higher. If now the transmitting node starts transmitting a dominant signal, then the transmitter output stage will switch on and the impedance change from high ohmic to low ohmic, for example, 30 ohm. During the dominant phase, and really I say here phase, not bit, because you can have more than one dominant bit. So during this dominant phase, the transmitter is low impedant and is waiting until the TXD change to one again. And then the transmitter output impedance change from low impedant to high impedant back to recessive, what we had also at the beginning. This impedance changes from high ohmic to low ohmic and vice versa. This impedance changes causes the ringing and reflection, what we here to see on the bus if you are looking in a star topology. And this also limits the maximum possible bitrate, what we can achieve in a star topology. But why we have ringing and why we have reflections? So it's a little bit here the transmission line theory, the responsible theory for that. So if the impedance at the end of a wire has the same value like the wire impedance itself, then it's everything is fine. You have no reflection. You can achieve the highest possible bit rates in this network. But if the impedance at the end of the wire is different, for example, higher than the transmission impedance itself, then this causes reflection with the same polarity. If it is vice versa, that means the impedance at the end of a transmission line is lower than the transmission line impedance itself, then you have a reflection with reverse polarity. So you have reflection, but the polarity depends on the condition, is the impedance at the end higher or lower than the transmission line impedance itself. And here we have a simple formula for this kind of reflection. You see that the termination at the end of a wire and the wire impedance is a part of this formula. And if you use this formula, then you have here some examples for reflection factors. So if the termination impedance are 30, 40, 60, and so on ohm, then you see here the value of the reflection depends on the wire impedance. So as lower the impedance of the wire is, as lower is the reflection value again. Now, okay, in which situation you have which condition? In a point-to-point network, with a termination, really an ohmic termination at the end of a wire, everything is fine. You have no reflection, theoretically. So the requirement that you have no reflection is that the unshielded twisted pair has a low temperature dependency. So that means that you have, under all circumstances, under all conditions, the wire impedance is stable. If the wire impedance changes over temperature, then it might be that you get over temperature, also reflection in this kind of network. Depends how big is the difference to these termination resistors. So also the termination resistor must be very precise, but this is standard at the moment. But in general, if you have a point-to-point network, then you have less reflection in this network. But how does it look in such a small star topology? So here you have an unterminated node, which should transmit data. You have here a star point in the center of the wire. You have here one unterminated node. You have here two terminate the nodes which are receiving in receiving mode only. And now, for these both nodes, you have here the condition without any reflection. So the impedance of the wire and of the termination is the same, no reflection. Here on this transmitting node and otherwise on this unterminated receiving node, you have on the one hand side the condition that the line impedance is lower than the termination at the end. If both nodes are transmitting recessive. And so that means on this transmitting node, you have also the second condition that during transmitting dominant, you have the condition that the line impedance is higher than the termination impedance of this transmitting node. So you are toggling between two different conditions here on this transmitting node. And this permanent toggling, this permanent changes of the impedance, this cause reflection, and here the transmitting node is the root cause and the main source for reflection in a CAN network. A little bit to show how the reflection starts. So you transmit, for example, a dominant signal. So we are changing from recessive to dominant. Then the waveform is walking over the wire to this star point. And here you have the first reflection. On the one hand side, you reflect the signal to the transmitting node back. And also the rest of the signal is walking to the receiving nodes. But one part is reflected to the transmitting node. And here now you have the situation that this node has a higher termination than the wire impedance. So then here you create an amplification of the reflected waveform. And here on the transmitting node depends which situation you have. Is the node transmitting a dominant signal? Then you have a little bit more or less elimination of the reflected signal. But if you have changed from dominant to recessive, then you have also amplification of the reflected signal back to the star point. Here on top, this both nodes are uncritical because here the termination and the wire impedance are matching perfectly. So here you have no trouble. To show you waveforms, I have used here this star topology with 5 meter wire length for each wire. And what you see here is really a short dominant signal. And then you have here the transition from dominant to recessive. And I have here used the solution where the recessive phase is much longer than a dominant phase. And you see you have long ringing here on this transmitting node in the recessive phase. On the star point, you see due to the reflection, the waveform looks really extremely nice. This is coming to the reflection from here and here to the center point, and then here you have an elimination of this reflection. On this perfect terminated nodes here, you see also the really the nice waveforms, but on this unterminated node, you see also this long ringing in the recessive phase. You see that the amplitude and the voltage swing is lower than on the transmitting node, because here a part of the amplitude is reflected to the transmitting node back. Yeah, but you see here this reflection also on this unterminated node. Yeah. So this is one example how this can look like in a star topology and how the reflection was created in this topology. So this ringing reduced the maximum possible bitrate, though it was the task to improve the concept of the transceiver, especially for the transmitting phase. And here, the so-called signal improvement concept was born. What does it mean? The only change on this SIG transceiver is that we have modified and improved the behavior of the transmitter, the driver itself. So if you look here on this typical waveform, recessive, dominant, recessive, what I have also shown before with KNFD transceiver, then this phase 1, 2, 3, so the high impedance phase, the change from recessive to dominant and the dominant phase itself are exactly the same like you have it in a KNFD transceiver. The difference now is the transition from dominant to recessive. So in this transition, at first, you have a phase which is meanwhile called active recessive. So that means that the transceiver impedance change from 30 to 100 ohm. So this roundabout the impedance of a wire. And this is the main difference to KNFD transceiver. The KNFD transceiver has changed from 30 ohm to high ohmic, 12 kilo ohm and higher. But here at the beginning, we are changing to a medium impedance phase called active recessive phase. And then after a certain time, which is around about 500 nanoseconds, we are changing to passive recessive like you know it from the past. So then we have the same condition like with the KNFD transceiver. So only for a limited time of 500 nanoseconds, which can be also shortened if a transceiver has to transmit a shorter bit, recessive bit. So then this active recessive time is limited by the length of the TXT zero state. So then here we suppress the reflection and the ringing on the transmitting node and can achieve higher bit rates than in a typical KNFD network. Now using the same setup like before, you can see the difference between a KNFD transceiver and a CAN-SIG transceiver here on the transmitting node. So you see here that the ringing really is suppressed. So this small ringing is below 500 millivolt. So, and with this new kind of transceiver, you can achieve higher bit rates. But there's also another story, and this is that the transceiver a little bit changed the duty cycle or the length of the bits. So this is here on top, the transmitted TXT signal, in this case, one recessive and one dominant bit. And here really the bit length for both are exactly the same. But on the RXD pin, on a receiving node, you can see that this length of the dominant bit and recessive bit are changing, caused, for example, by the transmitted recessive bit with time which is specified for the transmitter. So the transmitter is not absolutely perfect, it's not symmetric, and that causes an extension or reduction of the recessive bit time. And although the receiver on the receiving node side shorten the recessive bit time or extend the recessive bit time, although this receiver is not really symmetric, it's also specified in the standard in which range or how asymmetric this transceiver can be. And though you vary here really the bit timing for dominant and recessive bits. And also the oscillator has an impact. So the oscillator are not really perfectly using, for example, 40 megahertz. One oscillator is faster, the other one is slower. This causes all the variation of the bit time here at the beginning on the TXT for itself. It's not really exactly 200 nanoseconds, for example, though it's a little bit longer or shorter. And this causes all the situation that at the end, the recessive bit becomes shorter and longer. Then we have this synchronization segment, and we have also impact on the interfaces between the microcontroller and the transceiver. Nobody is taking into account that although this interface between the CAN-SIG controller itself and the input pin of a transceiver and vice versa are not really symmetric. So you have also here a modification of the bit length. This with higher bit rates, this has to be taken into account too. So that means, from this point of view, this can be the range where the duty cycle, more or less, of recessive and dominant bit is changing. So you can see it really on your oscilloscope if you're looking at the RxD pin. And this has an impact on the maximum possible bit rate too. So here we have also done an improvement for SIG transceiver. And what I have done, I have used the part which extend the recessive bit time. I have moved now in this U, and only to show what the impact is, so I have used this now here to this side, to the falling edge of the RxD signal that you see at the end. If you use a KNFD transceiver at 5 megabit, which means you have 200 nanosecond time, that then the time for your, or the possibility for your sample point is very small. So you see here for 80 megahertz CAN clock, the time quantas, and you see theoretically you have 1, maximum 2 time quantas for your sample point available. So what we have done is we have specified SIG transceiver more symmetric for the transmitter and the receiver. And this is the outcome. So you see here this range and this range become much more smaller. And this means you have now more possibilities for your sample point, or if you have more room for network effects. If you have such a critical network that you have ringing at the end, but only 1 or 2 times, then you have here a little bit margin for this. And if you, for example, if you set sample point to TQ10, then you have here more margin than with 5 megabit. But also here, we are limited. If you're looking the comparison between 5 megabit and 8 megabit, you see also with KenSIG transceiver, the area for sample point becomes smaller. And though that means we had now to find a new solution for KenXL transceiver supporting higher bit rates. And the solution is what the requirements were, also using or acting like a KenFD transceiver in the arbitration phase, supporting higher bit rates in the data phase. Compatibility between CAN, KenFD, and SIG transceiver was required. And there was at the end the requirement also that the output stage are close to the wire impedance to minimize the reflection. And this is now the solution. In the data phase, we are using now the push-pull driver concept. That means we have here at level 1, which means TXD is 1. Level 1, we have a low impedance phase. We have a low impedance phase during the transition from level 1 to level 0. Level 0 is also low impedance. The transition from level 0 to level 1 impedance. So everything is from low impedance. And the impedance is matching with the Meyer impedance perfectly. So and this concept allows us to support up to 20 megabit at the network. The disadvantage is that error frames cannot be supported in the data phase anymore. So, but Florian will tell you what here the solution is. So here, again, a little bit of a look how the transmitter concept now of the KenSIG XL transceiver is working. So, in the SIG mode, means in the arbitration mode, transceiver is acting like a KenFD transceiver or a SIG transceiver. And here in this simplified block diagram of a transceiver, it can be that you see here, you have here an own transmitter for the slow mode. But in the data phase, we are changing from SIG mode into this push-pull driver stage mode, can be realized with the own transmitter. And afterwards, we are switching back at the end of the frame. So the impedance is, like I said, 105 ohm. We have level 0 and level 1. And this is meanwhile verified with the first test chips, supports really higher bitrate up to 20 megabit. How is now the concept for the receiver on this new condition? In the SIG mode, no change. The receiver behaves the same like KenFD and SIG transceiver. same threshold, nothing changed. And here might be that in a Canon 6XL transceiver device, you have your own comparator or receiver for this sig mode. In the data, in the fast mode, so in the data field, now we switch the receiver thresholds to zero. That the threshold is symmetric to the levels on the bus. The tolerance is very small. This was plus minus 100 milliwatt. It might be that also in the transceiver, you have your own comparator for this. So this centered threshold voltage improves the signal integrity and also improves the symmetry of the receiver components. So now if you're using the really the fast mode of a Canon 6XL transceiver, then it must be guaranteed that the mode of the protocol and the transceiver mode are really the same. And we have here the situation that, for example, the protocol handler of a receiving node is not able to detect the frame correctly. So it has an internal error flag. Then this node will switch from fast mode into the arbitration mode back. So on the bus, you have a transmitting node transmitting in fast mode, but one receiving node has been switched back into arbitration mode and is in the so-called reintegration phase. If you have this scenario, then you have some problems, or you might have some problems that the level on the bus is lower than the receiver thresholds in sig mode. So it might be that you have here a permanent one on the IXD pin. And for the CAN controller, it means end of frame field is detected. And then it might be that the node starts transmitting in parallel to the running communication on the bus. To avoid this, we have implemented another comparator, which is called out-of-band comparator. And this comparator is looking in sig mode, is another node transmitting in fast mode. So then you have a toggling on the IXD pin here. And that means for the CAN controller, oh, somebody is talking on the bus. So I cannot reintegrate. And so with this out-of-band comparator, we have closed the gap and we have solved this critical topic. Here are the main parameters for the new CAN 6XL transceiver. As I said, no change in slow mode or sig mode. This is a new parameter in fast mode. The same for the receiver. No change in slow mode or sig mode. And these new parameters we have in fast mode and the out-of-band comparator is looking on negative differential voltages in a range of 350 milliwatt. So to detect communication in fast mode, if somebody is transmitting in fast mode while this device is in sig mode. Here are the results of our first and rough developed test chip. So here you see at the beginning a slow phase, more or less in sig mode. Then you have a fast phase, really in this fast mode. But here's the transition at the end is not like in the standard, was developed before the standard was fixed. But what you see here in this network where you have seen in this CAN-FD transceiver, really high reflection and long ringing, you see here that the signal looks perfect. So in the same network, which is limited at 2 megabit for this CAN-FD transceiver, you can achieve more than 10 megabit with the new CAN 6XL transceiver. So this is here the bus signal of the receiver, and this is here of the transmitting node, and also on transmitting node, you see a little bit more ring. The same with this kind of network, which is used for 5 megabit with SIG transceiver, you can also achieve higher bit rates with CAN 6XL transceiver. So what is my conclusion? First message, the CAN-XL protocol can be used in combination with all kind of transceiver. In combination with CAN 6XL transceiver, you can achieve up to 20 megabit, but you are flexible. So it's not really fixed to a bit rate for big and long networks, you can also use KenXL with 100 kilobit. KenXL transceiver supports star topologies and daisy chain. And the specification are more or less released at the moment. They are in CIA internal review, but we in the working group has done our job. Everything is fixed. And from my point of view, the protocol and the KenXL transceiver is ready for the future. And only one last hint. On Thursday, 9 a.m. Central European Summer Time, there's also a webinar, KenXL Physical Layer Option, where I'd like to welcome you here. Thank you very much, and thank you for your attention.